Northwestern keys its offense from the outside. You'll see some good shooting if Northwestern's going to be in this ball game today, Rick.
Freddie Darrough, their main threat from the outside. He's averaging 18.5 points a game, and he can light it up.
And Cooley has a young team, the man who won the game for him yesterday, a junior.
Daniel Lyton, 6'7", a junior. He made the two free throws at the end that clinched the win in the semis over the defending champion Detroit Southwestern.
Okay, we will be back for the championship of Class A in the state of Michigan. It is Detroit Cooley and Flint Northwestern on the Michigan High School Athletic Network. Welcome. This is the Class A championship game of the 1988 Michigan High School Basketball State Tournament, featuring Detroit Cooley and the Wildcats of Flint Northwestern High School. Now, prior to the game, the singing of the national anthem, done today by Tina Spezia, a student at Lutheran North High School in Mount Clemens, Michigan.
Tina Spezia, who is a student at Lutheran North High School in Mount Clemens, Michigan. What's your office today now? Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Tina Spezia from Mount Clemens, Lutheran North High School, the national anthem. Flint Northwestern 18-9 on the season, the real Cinderella team, and Detroit's Cooley Cardinals, the defending champions, 23-3, coached by Ben Kelso. The Class A championship game, if they can equal the great B game that we saw earlier this morning, with South Christian of Grand Rapids defeated Redford Bishop Borges 69-66. It will be a spectacular thing to behold. Now with the starting lineups here is PA announcer Howard King.
Flint Northwestern and Detroit Cooley. Here are the starting lineups. For Northwestern, at forward, a 6'3 senior, number 25, Reggie Richardson.
Reggie Richardson's one of the best rebounders for
Northwestern. For Cooley at forward, a 6'3
injured
senior.
Earlier this year.
23, Raphael Peterson.
Raphael Peterson averaging 24.5 points a game.
Northwestern forward, 6'1 senior, number 31, Preston Walker.
Preston Walker, a man forward, underneath who does a lot of muscle work for Wildcats.
Maurice Benson. Northwestern center, 6'6 junior, number 45.
William Page came eligible the second half of the season, has been a big factor. He's a smooth worker inside for Northwestern. Lighten, the young man who won the game against Southwestern yesterday with the free throw.
Northwestern, 6 foot senior. Number 23, Ronald Thompson. Cooley guard, 5'8 junior. Number 10, Derwin Good. And a guard for Northwestern, 6 foot senior, number 33, Freddie Darrough. Cooley guard, 6 foot junior, number 14, Michael Talley,
another junior was on that team.
Flint Northwestern is coached by Grover
Kirkman.
Talley was a pivotal figure in that game against Detroit Southwestern. You go, played a very good game. For Northwestern in this championship game, we will look for Thompson and Darrow to shoot it up from the outside. They can do that. If they are hot, Northwestern stands a good chance to play. Also, Northwestern will attempt to use its quickness. Cooley, like Northwestern, had problems early in the season, got everything together about midway through, and then began to roll, culminating with, of course, the big victory over Southwestern by 2 points yesterday in the semifinals. Our officials for the Class A game are Walt Popick from Huntington Woods and Dennis Mayer from Okanis. Larry Burkett from Royal Oak is the alternate official in case one of them has to leave.
That's quite an honor even being named as an alternate official just to get here. And in most cases, the one who is an alternate official 1 year, the following year, makes it to actually officiate the game on the court.
Here we go. Cooley in white with the red and black trim. Northwestern in green with the gold and white trim. Lyton will jump it up for Cooley against Page of Northwestern. Northwestern trying to win its first state title since 1985. Cooley trying to repeat. Cooley wins the tip. Ball comes out to the top of the key now to Derwin Good. Over to Tally. They'll run it back. Good pressure on the defense from Freddie Darrow from Flint Northwestern. Off the side, drop off shot is up. No good, and rebounded by Northwestern. Doing the work underneath again, Preston Walker.
Remember, look for the guard, Thompson and Darrell. Darrell number 33, Thompson number 23. They can shoot the ball. Thompson goes inside, puts up a bad shot. Rebound, outlet pass intended, but intercepted by Northwestern.
Derwin Good had the right idea with the pass. The man had a half step, he just underthrew it.
The Northwestern will now settle it down. Darrell and Thompson working the backcourt. Gonna fire it up from outside, no good. Rebound in there by Lyton. And Lyton gets it off to Good, and here we go again the other way. Still scoreless, almost a minute gone in the first period.
Cooley playing man-to-man, but Flint Northwestern here in a zone.
Northwestern is primarily a zone team, and they will play that all game long. Foul on William Page on the shot put up by Maurice Benson. It'll be Page's first foul of the ball game.
Well, so far, again, it's you can see both teams out there trying to feel each other out, get a little bit loose. As you're going to look over there, Ben Kelso, and what a job he's done establish himself. And it's just his fourth year of coaching already, well-respected across the state for his success.
Kelso moved to Flint as a teenager from the South, played in recreation basketball in Flint, never played high school basketball, but was discovered by Dick Parfitt down there, then went to Central Michigan University, became a great player up there, and now has gone on to coaching.
Maurice Benson at the line.
Misses both.
Lyton, though.
Lyton grabs the rebound, and Cooley will set it up again out to Tally. The junior, who's going to run the offensive show. Benson underneath, and finally to Benson, and he scores, and it is 2-0.
Raphael Peterson made it, really, though, happen with that nice entry pass and the power jam by Benson.
Freddie Darrow averaging about 19 points a game. Thompson averages 20. Darrow tries to take it himself, finds nothing there, and gets it out to Thompson. Underneath the page, the junior center, shot short, rebounded by Benson. And the Cardinals regain control, and Tally says, let's settle things down.
So far, Cooley doing a good job blocking off, denying any potential offensive rebounds.
In the corner, Peterson quickly underneath the Benson. He puts it up, missed the shot, rebounded by Northwestern. The Wildcats on the run. Thompson holds it up. Nothing there. In the corner, shot bounces off and rebounded down by Cooley, and we get a foul on the back. And that foul was against Reggie Richardson, the best rebounder for Northwestern, but he was really out of position to get that rebound.
Watch number 30, Maurice Benson here, come in white, get position. Shot comes in, go to the right, 30 has position. When you get position, you're going to get the ball 9 times out of 10.
Pressure now from Northwestern on the inbounds play. Just sort of just bothersome pressure, more mostly. Tally underneath now. Lyton shot is knocked away, but the rebound is in by Benson. He has four. Cooley has four. It's 4-0.
Looked like Lyton was looking for the slam that time. He lost it on the way up, but ever the alert Benson there to take advantage.
Darrell now exploring the outside. Now works to his left. Stops. Kuhlman calls on him. No foul. Pass underneath the page. He gets the bounce. 4-2.
William Page saw him in the quarterfinals. Seemed to make all his points count.
That'll be steps. Good defensive pressure there. Flint Northwestern lost their first four games of the season. They were never together as a team, as an entire unit, all healthy until the last game of the regular season. They've now won 8 in a row and come in at 18-9.
They had two players, Page and Thompson, ineligible in the first half of the season. And Richardson, the star rebounder, was hurt much of the first half of the season. So it took him a while. Darrell from the outside. Shot bounces off. Benson grabs it. It falls to Richardson's hands for Northwestern. He puts up a shot. We're tied at four.
Reggie Richardson inside. Gets a 15 to 12 footer. That's where he feels most at home.
And we get a traveling call against Cooley. Little pressure that time from Darrell and Thompson at the backcourt. And Northwestern will try to take its first lead in the ballgame. 5:04 to go, first period. Glad to have you watching on Michigan High School Athletic Association Network. Ready, Darrell, Ron Thompson. Thompson with a knee brace. The right knee. He's gonna try to drive the lane, puts up a tough shot, falls. Benson with another rebound.
Four rebounds for Benson already. Three defense, one offense.
Tally now, top of the key. Corner, back to Tally, other side, Peterson. Doesn't want to put it up from 12 feet. Gets it instead to Lyton underneath. Shot blocked by Page, but it'll be Page's second foul of the ball game.
Peterson had that 15-footer, as you mentioned, Ed. He passed it inside, though, got a little bit closer. Lyton went up and drew the foul. We'll watch.
This could be a pivotal factor in the game, right? Very early, like Stenzica this morning had a foul, second foul early. Page picks up one for Northwestern. And we get a substitution.
Second foul on Page.
Archie Mullerlin, a 6'5 sophomore, comes in replacing Page.
Really having problems at the line so far, 0 for 3.
Mullerlin is 6'5, 225. He replaces Page up front. Now, he will not give them the offense that Page would, but he's just going to have to do the job on the board.
Locks up a lot of space defensively,
yeah,
doesn't he?
Lyton misses again. Cooley.
Benson, another rebound.
Another rebound, but four missed free throws by the Cardinals. Tally from about 18 feet finds it.
Tally impressed everybody last year in the championship game.
6-4, the Cardinals in white. Corner now, Thompson back to Darrell. Cooley in the zone defense. Thompson comes around. Good defense by Gould. Thompson puts up a tough shot. Does not get the fall, but the rebound is almost grabbed off by Mullerlin, who just came into the ballgame, and instead we get a foul on Ron Thompson.
Well, you mentioned Mullerlin. That was the closest that Northwestern's come to getting an offensive rebound. He came in there, snuck his way in, pulled it down, but lost it on the way down.
Now, Northwestern on the tournament trail has fallen behind before and has been able to come back. They've also had big leads before in this tournament, lost them, and then regained the skill in order to win the ball game. Here is Cooley on a bit of a run, but they'll slow it up. They're careful, well coached, disciplined pretty well by Ben Kelso. Underneath the Benson, boy's a big load in there, isn't he? Tally from the three-point range gets two. Stephens had his put on the line.
Just a couple inches away from getting three that time.
Cooley doubles the score on Northwestern, it's 8-4. The Wildcats yet to hit from the outside. Walker back to Darrell, tapping on him, Peterson on him. Knocked away by Tally, Tally on the run. He chased by Richardson, misses the layup, Benson with a rebound.
Boy, if there is one story to this point, it's the rebounding of Maurice Benson. He has 6 boards already and 6 points as well.
3:13 to go in the first period, it's 10-4. Darrell's shot is good. Freddie finally breaks the ice.
He needed that one.
Yes, he did.
He's a good shooter. Got off to a little bit of a rough start.
Gerwin Good, number 10. 5'8 junior. Three juniors start for Cooley. They'll have both their guards back next year. Plus, they will also have Lyton in the center. And we get a foul on Darrell. That will be Cooley's Northwestern's fifth foul of the period.
Checking into the Northwestern lineup, number 21, Broderick Powell.
He's another junior who will give him some physical help underneath.
And Cooley already shooting the bonus. That's normally good news, but they're 0 for 4 from
they're
the line.
They're 0 for 4 from the line, so we're not sure yet. Although Tally, I think, is probably a pretty good 3-point shooter. He missed. Rebound in there by Mullerlin. Here come the Wildcats, trying to cut the margin to two.
Watch the defense now, the aggressive man-to-man and smart defense by Cooley.
Roderick Powell out high now, looking for some help, and he gets it from Ron Thompson. Thompson settles things down with 2:30 to go in the first half. Thompson drives, pulls up, dumps it off to Munnelin, he puts it up and scores. And Archie Munnelin forced to play because of two quick fouls early in the cage, gets on the board. It's a 10-8 ball game. Darryl Talley, 6 foot junior, wears number 14 to Raphael Peterson. And Talley, far side. Pressure, drives the lane, ball stolen by Northwestern. Here come the Wildcats. Darryl in traffic, dumps it off to Reggie Richardson. He puts it up, he scores, and we're tied. Nice pass, nice play by Reggie. Back the other way, Talley. We're moving quickly from one end to the other.
Northwestern got it down and got it in, but they got beat defensively back.
12-10 Cooley with a minute 45 to go. Darryl pulls up, gets the pressure, gets the shot, and scores. Now Freddie is warming up. 12-12.
Points are going to start to fly now, I think, Ed.
Good puts it up. That's the first exchange shot, rebound by the Wildcats. They had a man on the break but didn't see him. Ron Thompson does now to Darryl. Darryl puts a move on, wraps it underneath to Richardson. Missed the shot. Maurice Benson with a rebound for the Cardinals. Pass out, intercepted. However, falling to the court was Broderick Power after he made the interception. He slipped and might have twisted an ankle.
Oh, he came down real hard right at midcourt and landed, I believe, on the small of his back.
Grover Kirkland, the veteran Flint Northwestern coach, out to see Broderick Powell, who had just come into the game. Powell was a junior, 6'2". And now he's getting to his feet. I think he's all right. Grover's a science teacher at Northwestern High School.
Well, not made the nice steal, came down.
Ben Kelso.
Say that Raphael Peterson.
Ben Kelso getting one of those unofficial timeouts. We'll put ball back in play right away. And it is going to be called Northwestern's ball.
We will call Peterson for the foul.
Here is Darryl. Pulls up from the top of the key. He's at three in a row now. Freddie is warming up to the occasion. Cooley now. Gregory Ward in the ballgame, number 20. Here's Benson at the free throw line. Pass knocked away by Munnerlin.
Munnerlin, a real force so far.
Munnerlin doing the job. Here's Ronnie Thompson driving the lane. Dumps it off. They'll swing around to the other side. Darryl's hot. Can we put another one up? No, he'll get called for traveling. Well, he missed the shot anyway. Pace
Lyton
is quickening.
Out. It certainly is. Lyton came out. We could feel Freddie Darryl was feeling it.
Yes, he was. You could see the glint in his eye. 51 seconds to go in the first quarter. Flint Northwestern 14, Detroit Cooley 12. In the Class A championship game. That's Darryl Talley. Number 14 for Cooley. Pressure picking up a little bit now for Northwestern. Cooley gets it over the timeline. Cross court pass to Talley, almost too tall for the 6'1 junior, but he was able to retrieve it. Peterson now looks at the clock and looks at Ben Kelso and says, maybe we'll slow it down and get the last shot. Talley underneath to Benson, of course, misses the shot, rebound, battle for Benson again. Slammed home that time by Light.
Boy, I tell you though, not to belabor the point, but Benson continues to be the key factor for Cooley inside. He kept it alive and then Talley finished it off.
14-14 with 17 seconds to go in the first quarter. Northwestern to play for the last shot now. Freddie Darrell's had the hot hand, he's got the ball, let's see if he can get open. Being pressured by Peterson. Goes to the right baseline, drops it back to Ronnie Thompson. Thompson with 5 seconds, 4-3, drives to the key, dumps it off underneath to Munnelin, he scores, and that will end the first quarter of the play. With a score, Flint Northwestern 16, Detroit Cooley 14. This is Ed Phelps and Rick Berkey. Welcome back to Chrysler Arena Ann Arbor. Period number two, the Class A state championship game with Detroit Cooley trailing Flint Northwestern 16-14 after 8 minutes of play.
Ed Cooley out rebounding Northwestern 12-6 in the first quarter.
Doesn't matter if Freddie Darrell continues to shoot like that. He's hit four in a row, and Northwestern now leads by four.
On the other side, though, Cooley committed six turnovers to just two for Northwestern.
A little bit of pressure from the Wildcats. Talley now over to Raphael Peterson. Raphael is a 6'3 senior, one of the two seniors that starts on this team, the Cooley Cardinals, of Ben Kelso. Underneath now to Daniel Lyton. He's a junior. He knocks it home. Lyton has four points. Nice entry pass is right. Darrell now running the show for the Wildcats of Northwestern. Trying to become the team with the second most losses ever. A total of 9 losses to win a state championship. 2 teams have won state championships with 10 losses. In 1967, Menominee had 10 losses. They finished at 13-10 before their losses were forfeits. However, in 1967, Marquette Barraga had 10 losses in the regular season in Class D. They finished the regular season at 8-10. They won 8 in a row and won the Class D title with a 16-10 record.
Great story.
Northwestern would finish with 9 losses if they win it today. Darrell now from the corner for 3, little short. Rebounded, however, by the Wildcats. Shot put up, missed, rebound. Benson pounds in there hard, and we get a pushing call. I believe it's against George Ward.
With Preston Walker, watch number 31. Preston Walker comes in, gets the offensive rebound in the middle here. And the foul comes in the flurry afterwards.
Walker comes out of the field of play there, didn't he?
Yeah. Second look, you see the... Get a better look right there. Good call by the officials.
Inbounds to Darrell, and to Ron Thompson, pardon me. Thompson's first basket of the ball game. It is now 20-16 for Northwestern. Peterson for the Cardinals of Cooley. Ward back to Peterson. They work the perimeter against the Northwestern zone. Entry pass into Lytton, but he drops it back to Peterson. Peterson from about 17 feet. Shot bounce off the iron and will go out of bounds. William Page back into the game for Northwestern. Page had to sit out early with 2 fouls. Sat out for about half of the first quarter, but Archie Munnellan did a good job for Northwestern while he was in there with 4 points.
4 points and a couple rebounds did Munnellan get in that period of play.
Darrell, he's red hot. Looks like it's going to be a little short. It was. Rebounded by Benson. He has 7 in the ball game. The Cardinals now, down deep, Peterson over to Tally, swing it around. Again, they'll try and get it into Lyton. And they did get it into Lyton. The shot is so good, but we have a foul on the play.
The ball reversal here by Cooley, the key. It starts in the left corner, they zip it around, and they beat the defense, getting back over to that side, and the foul picked up
by
on Page,
William Page.
And that's his third foul there.
William Page, third foul of the ball game. He goes out again, and Munnellan comes back into the ball game. Had no position, no reason to even try and block that shot. He was completely out of position. He was beaten. Could have just had Lytton get the 2 points.
Lytton will get 2 now. He's 0 for 2 so far from the line. And finally, he breaks the ice there.
L-Y-T-O-N, Lytton. Daniel Lytton, 6'7 junior.
First make after 5 misses for Cooley.
Now they found the range. Lyton makes both of them. We have a 2-point ball game with 6 minutes to go in the first half. Reddie Darrough working hard for the Wildcats. Now sets up at the top of the key, explores the left side, finds Ron Thompson. Thompson, a good shooter with 1 basket. He drops it off to Richardson, has to arch it high over Benson. He does, he scores.
That was a major league shot because, yes, as you said, it came out, the defender had it timed pretty well, and he just compensated with a little more arch.
Peterson's pass is knocked out of the hands of Benson and out of bounds. Just kind of token pressure by Northwestern in the backcourt.
Peterson doesn't miss much with the ball out front. He will see you. If you're open, he'll usually get it into you.
Looks like he's been a little shy of shooting today, but I'm sure he'll warm up before it's all over. Derwin good. Peterson, they swing the ball around again, trying for that pass to Lyton. They get it. Benson high into the air. He is, as they say, playing above the rim and slams it home.
That is his 10th rebound in addition to his 8th point.
Oh. That is not bad. Freddie Darrough, 22-20. Thompson in the corner. Can't get 3 of Tally. Looking for some help now. Cuts it up to the top of the key. Back to his left. Throws it up. No good. Munnellan grabs the rebound. Misses. Thompson follows his own shot and scores.
That's a roundabout way to get 2 points. Thompson will take it, so will the Wildcats.
You aren't kidding. Tally and Derwin good. It's good, calling for his players to come to the ball. Peterson, a 24-point scoring average, but hasn't done much today. The Cardinals definitely slowing down the pace. They'd love to get it into Lyton. They feel that they could score all day
against the Wildcats in there. Right now, he's defended by Ron Thompson, and that's a 5-inch difference in height. But the basket is good from the outside.
Well, Northwestern packing that zone a little tighter, saying, hey, Cooley, you're going to have to show us you can shoot from out. Irwin Good just did that. That might turn things around down the road.
Good's first basket of the game, again, a two-pointer. Ron Thompson shot a short. Thompson goes underneath amongst the Giants and gets hammered. Lyton with the foul.
We'll watch Ronald Thompson, number 25 here, go to the hoop.
Take it underneath, back up, foul. Thompson was ineligible this first semester of this basketball season. He was one of the top scorers in the Saginaw Valley last year as a junior.
Averaged 20 points a game since he became eligible at this semester.
Actually averaged more than that last year, but they're a better team this year. That's a trademark of a good team, to spread out that score. Four ten to go in the first half. Northwestern 24, Cooley 22. This one is building to the same type of crescendo that we had in the Class B game.
The first free throws in the game for Flint Northwestern.
That one's a little long. Rebound, however, and put back up, blocked by Benson, grabbed off by the Cooley Cardinals. That was Preston Walker who tried to put it up and had it swatted away by Benson, who's been a strong figure in this game.
Everywhere. Maurice Benson is everywhere on the court right now.
Derwin Good takes his time now for Cooley. Works the right side to Ward. Back to Good at the top of the key.
You see Northwestern's brought that zone out a little bit higher now.
Now they get it underneath. Lyton puts a shot up. It's no good, but he is hammered.
Pass a little bit deep, but Lyton, good hands, went up and got it. Actually went underneath the basket, very close to going out of bounds. Watch 42 Lyton come out, though. He'll fake underneath. And draw the foul.
There's the foul. Into the ball game for Northwestern is Anthony Bridges, number 11. You see him just off to the free throw shooter's left. He's a mighty mite at 5 feet, 7 inches tall. He has replaced Freddie Darrough for a moment to give Darrough a little breather. Right now. You can tell what happens. He kind of snaps that ball off his hands rather than getting rid of it softly. So if he's on with it, it's going to be a good shot, but if it's at least a little bit off, it's going to bounce far away. Tally back in. He replaces Ward for the Cardinals.
Well, Lyton.
Watch his release here if we get a good shot of it. He kind of snaps it with his hands. Well, that wouldn't work. That'll work, actually.
Missed his first two. He's hit four straight.
24-24. Anthony Bridges. Over to Broderick Powell now. Bridges trapped along the sideline, but gets free. Bridges can scoot. Got no place to go, so why not put it up?
Got That's caught up in the air. Exactly the last thing he wanted to do was shoot it, but why not, Anthony?
Whatever works, works. 26-24 with 3:15 to go in the first half. Michael Talley now into the corner. Back out to Talley. Underneath to Benson. Benson's shot bounced off and hammered underneath for Flint Northwestern as Broderick Powell, who had position for the rebound.
All right, now we'll watch Benson now. He's been the four-time board. He said this time a little too over-aggressive. He tried to go through two players. Watch 30 come into the middle here after the miss.
Yeah, he reached over.
From the other angle, you'll see him come in a little bit better there. And he bumps Broderick Powell. We'll go the other way. Powell shoots a one-on-one.
Powell at perfect position. Powell, 6'2", junior.
Averages 4 points and 4 rebounds a game for the Wildcats.
Doesn't get the roll, but the rebound. Oh, little Bridges almost stuck in there and got that rebound. Almost.
Mr. Lyton wouldn't have taken too kindly to that, I don't think.
Cooley with a chance to tie now. Tally goes back to the corner. They really work that right side. Tally again to the corner. Darren Good. Good now to Tally. Let's see what they do. Peterson's not coming to the ball, so Tally really has nothing other than to do than pass into the corner. They get it to Lyton. Lyton's shot is no good, but he is hammered by Archie Munnery.
Again, a good move inside by Lyton. Initially, he watched Lyton get the pass here. He's thinking, dunk, I think. Watch it. He's got position, turns inside, decides to go underneath, then uses the rim to shield the ball from the defender and draws the foul.
tell you one thing, you put the Lyton and Runner in football uniforms, I think you'd have yourself a couple of linebackers.
Yeah, they play, where do they play? They play anywhere they want.
That's right. The Lyton, after missing his first four, is on a roll now. He's made four in a row.
Now has 9 points.
Five of them from the charity stripe. This one would tie the ball game. And it does. 2:34 to go in the first half. It's 26-26. Reggie Cash, a 6'6 junior, comes in, replacing Maurice Benson for the Cardinals.
So far, Ed, I think we'd have to say Flint Northwestern had, you know, with the Cinderella story, more pressure on them. They've handled themselves very well here in the state final.
Freddie Darrough back on the floor. Ball is knocked away by Tally, and it will go out of bounds to the Wildcats. Cooley, for the first time, trying some pressure on the inbounds play. That has backfired against most teams that have used it against Northwestern this year. They are very quick. Bridges now drops it off. Great feed to Munnerling, but he missed the shot. Oh, that was a pretty feed.
Anthony Bridges, great penetration. And zipped it over, but the shot wouldn't fall. But if Bridges can get inside like that, it'll be good things for Flint Northwestern.
That's for sure. Tally, Peterson, Peterson, top of the key. Bridges, the 5'7 guy on the 6'3 Peterson.
Rafael Peterson really needs a shot from the outside drop.
Well, I think he wants, he doesn't look like he wants to shoot.
He's going to have to for Cooley to win this game, I believe. You have to make a couple from the out.
Good in the corner there against Reggie Richardson. Now the cross, now they skip pass to Rafael Peterson. He takes it inside the free throw line and misses his shot. Hammers away, but the rebound is grabbed down by Richardson. Here's Bridges now scooting for Northwestern. Holds it up, keeps his dribble. He's got someplace to go. Yes, to Munnerling. Munnerling converts.
Again, Anthony Bridges getting inside. The defense had to cover to him. And Munnerling got open for the five-footer. Munnerling with 6 points.
I'll tell you, that Bridges can scoot. Whoa. Here's Peterson. He'll crack in from about 7 feet. Use for the glass for his first basket of the game. Here's Bridges on a run. They won't slow down. 28-28. With a minute 15 to go in the first half.
This has been a quick first half in more ways
Darrow,
than one.
Darrow, he's got it. Freddie Darrow, pretty looking shot. 10 points. Four in this period. Here's the Cooley Cardinals on the run now. No place to go for number 10, Derwin Good, and he is absolutely leveled by Archie Munnerling.
Let's watch
the replay.
5'8 Derwin Good going in against Munnerling. 6'5, 225.
And Good doesn't go down. Munnerling does. But it's a foul. Ooh.
I think he ducked right at the right time, no Ed.
Derwin misses the first one. 30-28 Northwestern. Less than a minute to go in the first half. Now Ron Thompson comes back in for the Wildcats, and he replaces Munnerling, so this is going to be a very small Northwestern team out there, basically a three-guard unit with Darrow, Thompson, and Bridges all out there for the Wildcats. Good misses the second one, rebound. Thompson tried for it, missed it, and he was fouled in there by Reggie Cash, so that really works out well for Northwestern.
Go the other way and shoot the one-on-one. As you cash just in the lineup there for Cooley. 6'6 junior. Where does Ben Kelso get these underclassmen? Remember, we were shaking our heads
last year.
Sophomores and juniors that were playing so well. Peterson and Tally and company.
Now Munnerling comes back in the ballgame for Northwestern, replacing Bridges. Bridges did a good job for the Wildcats. He speeded up play a little bit, got him a couple of easy baskets. Ron Thompson.
2 from the line so far today.
Northwestern with a 2-point lead in the final minute of the first half. Last B game this morning, won by Grand Rapids South Christian, 69-66 over Redford Bishop Borges.
Great
Grover
ball
Kirkland
game.
Talks to his team after Thompson makes his first 3-point. That was a great ball game this morning. This is a very good one this afternoon.
All in this quarter, make it six.
Make it six, make it a 4-point lead with 57 seconds to go. Here come the Cooley Cardinals, Derwin Good. trapped a little bit, but he gets the ball over to Peterson and to Tally. 49 seconds to go in the half. Peterson doesn't want to put it up. Tally's not a shooter. Out of Peterson, he's at the top of the key, but won't shoot. Cooley has got to shoot from there because Northwestern's packing in that zone so tightly. And it's tough to get that ball inside. Lyton's out of the ballgame now. They'd have to go into Benson. Tally won't shoot with 30 seconds to go. The corner out to Peterson, top of the key. Again, Tally looking for help from Coach Ben Kelso with 23 seconds to go. Northwestern by four. We are under 20 now. Northwestern, I mean, Cooley's going to be content now just to get off the last shot. 13 seconds, 12. Tally, Peterson, and Derwin, good play catch. Tally from about 15 feet, way short ball. It's knocked out of bounds. It should have gone off Cooley hands. It does. With 5 seconds to go, the Wildcats will get one last chance to make it a six-point lead.
Now, the first pass here is the key to getting a good shot off. They don't get it very far.
Here we go, but they can shoot it. Ron Thompson pulls up. No. And that is the end of the first half. The Northwestern Wildcats from Flint lead the Cooley Cardinals 30-28. We'll be back on the Michigan High School Sports Network. Ed Phelps along with Rick Berkey. Welcome back to Chrysler Arena, the campus of the University of Michigan. We are at halftime of the Class A State Championship game between Flint Northwestern and Detroit Cooley High School. And at the half, it is Northwestern's Wildcats, the Cinderella team this year, with a 32-28 halftime lead, Rick.
All right, well, we've got a special presentation here at the half. The Charles E. Forsyth Awards, awarded annually here at halftime of the Class A game. Let's go over to Howard King for the award presentation.
The Class A finals is the presentation of the Charles E. Forsyth Awards. This award is made to individuals who have made outstanding contributions in terms of service to the interscholastic athletic program in Michigan. There are two recipients of the award. We'll introduce them right now. Making the presentations today of the Forsyth Awards is Mr. Eric Federico, Director of Athletics at Trenton High School and member of the Representative Council of the MHSAA. The Michigan High School Athletic Association is pleased to honor Jack Johnson as the first Charles E. Forsyth Award winner in 1988. Mr. Johnson began coaching in 1954 while serving as athletic director and department chair at Bryant Junior High School in Durban. Beginning in 1958, Mr. Johnson served as athletic director and a department chairman at Durban High School and served in that capacity until his retirement in December of 1986. Mr. Johnson assisted in football as a coach for 5 years and spent 21 years as a swimming coach, 17 of those as head coach. His dual meet record was 193 wins to 58 losses, a record which included 13 league titles and 4 MHSAA championships. While Mr. Johnson was serving as athletic director at Durban High School, he served as a valuable counselor and advisor to many MHSAA committees. Mr. Johnson was a member of the MHSAA Representative Council from 1980 to 1986 and was active in numerous professional organizations. We congratulate Mr. Jack Johnson. The second recipient of the 1988 Charles E. Forsyth Award is Alan Williams. Mr. Williams is in his 29th year as athletic director at North Adams High School, where he also serves as a counselor at the school. Mr. Williams has also coached football and basketball at North Adams High School. His 6-year gridiron mark was 33-14, and he is in his 27th season as boys basketball mentor, carrying a record of 389-138 as of February 3rd. Mr. Williams is in his 9th term on the Representative Council of the MHSAA as the representative for Class CD schools in southeastern Michigan. He has held this position since 1971. He has also served as the Secretary Treasurer of the Council since 1981. The Chrysler fans join all of us in wishing our very best congratulations to these two fine recipients of the Charles E. Forsyth Award for 1988.
Congratulations to Jack Johnson and Alan Williams winning the Forsyth Awards during this Class A state championship basketball game. We'll be back with more. The score is Flint Northwestern 32, Cooley 28 at the half. We are very proud to be bringing you the state basketball championships here on the Michigan High School Sports Network. But none of this would be possible without the support of our network sponsors. Rick Berkey is standing by now with a special presentation to those sponsors.
I'm Rick Berkey, and I'm here with Jack Roberts, the executive director of the Michigan High School Athletic Association. The MHSAA boys basketball finals is always exciting, and we're happy to bring you the final games over the Michigan High School Sports Network. These games are being fed via satellite and carried by our great affiliate stations, WJRT in Flint, WXMI in Grand Rapids, WSYM in Lansing, WGTU in Traverse City, WLUC in Marquette, PASS Pro-Am Sports System, and Dimension Cable in Phoenix, Arizona. Of course, none of this would be possible without the support of the advertisers of the Michigan High School Sports Network, those people who believe in promoting high school sports throughout the state. Today, we would like to recognize these sponsors with this plaque, which reads, "Presented in recognition and appreciation for your sponsorship of the Michigan High School Athletic Association's 1988 Boys Basketball Tournament." With us today, from True Value Hardware, Mr. Jim Filak.
Jim, thank you very much for your support.
Thank you, Jack. I'd like to accept this on behalf of over 200 True Value members in Northern Michigan. Thank you.
From 7UP, Mr. Raj Molinar.
Raj, thank you very much for your support.
On behalf of Cherry 7UP, I would like to say we're very happy to be part of this great event.
From Aquinas College, Mr. Larry Randall.
Larry, thank you very much.
Thank you. The Aquinas College community is very happy to be a part of this big weekend.
And from Hudsonville Ice Cream Company, Mr. Del Jose.
Del, thank you very much for your support.
It's been a pleasure sponsoring high school basketball.
Thanks again to our affiliated stations for making this telecast of the 1988 MHSAA Boys Basketball Finals possible.
Berkey, welcome you back to Chrysler Arena in Ann Arbor, Michigan, the campus of the University of Michigan. It is halftime of the Class A state championship game between the Wildcats of Flint Northwestern and the Cardinals of Cooley in Detroit, the defending champions. And at the half, the score is Northwestern 32, Cooley 28. Both teams scoring the same amount of points in each quarter. 16-14 first quarter for Northwestern, 16-14 second quarter for Northwestern. How about some other stats, Rick?
Well, Freddie Darrough individually leads Northwestern with 10 points, 6 points apiece for Reggie Richardson, Ronald Thompson, and Archie Munderlin off the bench did a good job. On the other side for Detroit Cooley, Daniel Lyton, 10 points. He also had eight rebounds. And Maurice Benson had 8 points, but he had a big 10 rebounds individually, many of them offensive rebounds, staying inside. Earlier in the game, he was a force defensively on the boards. So overall, the boards game pretty even, though, because Northwestern came back strong in that second quarter on the boards after being out-rebounded considerably in the first quarter. Right now at the half, rebounding, Detroit Cooley has a slight edge, 17-16. We'll check out the team stats overall on both sides of the ball. First of all, you see that Cooley and Northwestern shooting about the same. Both teams struggling from the free throw line. The difference for Cooley, at least on the good side, is they're getting there more often. They're shooting about the same percentage, but they've got eight more opportunities, and they've made four more as a result of that. You see the turnovers. Northwestern, for as fast paced a game as they play, having only three turnovers at the half is a very impressive total, and not too bad for Cooley with six.
That may be the most impressive statistic of the first half.
You see the three-point shot attempt, Flint Northwestern 0-for-4, and Cooley has not taken one yet, and I'm a little surprised by that. Good tally. And Peterson out there, I think we'll take a couple before the day's done.
Most noticeable to me in the first half was Peterson, who came into the game with a 24-point average, has 2 points in the ball game and has not been a factor scoring-wise. His performance has been made up for by other factors for Cooley, but I think he has to get into it a little bit.
Remember last year we saw him score so many points in that state final game. One of his strengths is maybe his best strength, is faking the outside shot, getting a half step, going in, pulling up for about a 10-footer. Well, right now, as you mentioned in the first half, Flint is packing it in. They're giving him the outside shot, taking away that fake and move inside completely.
All right, here we go. Cooley's ball to start the second half. The Cardinals with the same lineup that began the ball game. Broderick Powell in there for Northwestern as the starter for this half. Tally, this is Peterson, and he immediately puts it up. He misses the shot, the rebound. Benson grabs at it, but it's Reggie Richardson from Northwestern who pulls it down. Here come the Wildcats. Ronnie Thompson, Green, he'll go to the top of the key to look for Freddie Darrough. No, he goes the other way, spins, drops it off to Page. Page with three fouls, hasn't been a factor, but gets the rebound now, has it knocked away by Benson. And the Cardinals will settle it down into the hands of Good and then Talley.
You mentioned it, Ed. That could be a factor. William Page with three fouls. How long will he play before he picks up that fourth?
Though Munnerlin did a good job as replaced before him in the first half.
There's Peterson.
Peterson puts it up. Shot is missed. Rebound. Strong put up there by Lyton, but he was fouled and missed the shot.
Watch 24, Raphael Peterson. Good penetration here inside. He drops it off to 42, Lyton.
And then he is hammered right there by Reggie Richardson. As I have Richardson for two fouls.
I do as well.
Okay.
Don't take my book. I was wrong in the first game.
Greg says he had two, so now I feel comfortable.
I'll go along with Greg Johnson.
Lyton gets the first point of the second half.
Well, he missed his first two free throws today, and he's now hit seven straight.
On a roll. Nice touch. It's a two-point ball game again. Never been a very widespread in any direction. Dara put his shoulder down, but no, he's going to get the blocking ball. That's kind of questionable, but Dara got the break that time. Looked like he put his shoulder down. Usually they will make that call against the offense.
Sherwin Good, though, moving a little bit perhaps defensively. Tried to get to that spot just ahead. Almost there, but not quite.
Reggie Richardson to inbound for Northwestern. He looks for Freddie Darrough, or rather Ron Thompson, who's got him in the corner. Thompson 23, Darrough 33, the outside threat. Drop the pass back to Darrough, sneaks in the side, but he is going to be hammered by Raphael Peterson. Peterson's first foul. 4 seconds.
We'll watch the penetration here by 33. Freddie Darrough inside, the good pump fake. And boy, the first time I saw it, I thought it was a foul. Peterson didn't like the call, but watching the replay there, it might have been pretty clean. But
that shows you what your angle and your relative position on the floor do. It was Peterson's second foul.
Let us not forget that the officials, they only have one angle as we do here at the court. Sorry.
They do not have a replay.
Darrough, the leading scorer for the Wildcats, now with 11.
33-30. Derwin Good now. Avoids the pressure. Pulls up at about 12 feet. Dumps it off to Lyton. Now snaps it off to Tally. Tally won't shoot. Instead takes it in and makes it easy. Nice drive to the hoop.
Well, Tally turned down that 15-footer. But found out he could get a 3-footer.
We're a 1-point ball game now. Darrough to Page. Back to Ron Thompson. Thompson. Top of the key. Off the corner to Richardson now. Northwestern trying to work around this Cooley zone. Pass intercepted by Raphael Peterson. 2-on-1 to Good. Good to put it up. Get the shot up. Over power on the board.
Great left hand by Derwin Good. Peterson hit him maybe a little too early, but he made a fine shot.
Oh, scoop underneath. Knocked away by Benson. Here come the Cardinals the other way, but the pass is intercepted by Broderick Powell. Powell gets it up court to Freddie Darrough. Darrough tries the lane. No. And is scared away by the Giants. And the ball is rebounded by the Cardinals. Here is Tally. Tally drops it off to Peterson. Yes. And Cooley all of a sudden has a 3-point lead. And timeout by Northwestern. All right, with the score, Cooley 36, Northwestern 33. We'll pause on the Michigan High School Athletic Association Network.
Three fouls. How long will he play before he picks up that fourth?
Though Munnerlin did a good job as replacement for him in the first half.
There's Peterson.
Peterson puts it up. Shot is missed. Rebound. Strong put up there by Lyton, but he was fouled and missed the shot.
Watch 24, Raphael Peterson. Good penetration here inside. He drops it off to 42. Lyton.
And then he is hammered right there by Reggie Richardson. As I have Richardson for two fouls.
I do as well.
Okay.
Don't take my book. I was wrong in the first game.
Greg says he had two, so now I feel comfortable.
I'll go along with Greg Johnson.
Lyton gets the first point of the second half.
Boy, he missed his first two free throws today, and he's now hit seven straight.
On a roll. Nice touch. It's a two-point ball game again. Never been a very wide spread in any direction. Darrough put his shoulder down, but no, he's going to get the blocking ball. That's kind of questionable, but Darrough got the break that time. Looked like he put his shoulder down. Usually they will make that call against the offense.
Sherwin good, though, moving a little bit perhaps defensively. Tried to get to that spot just ahead. Almost there, but not quite.
Reggie Richardson to inbound for Northwestern. He looks for Freddie Darrough, or rather Ron Thompson. He's got him in the corner. Thompson 23, Darrough 33, the outside threat. Drop the pass back to Darrough. Sneaks in beside, but he is going to be hammered by Raphael Peterson. Peterson's first foul. 4 seconds.
We'll watch the penetration here by 33. Freddie Darrough inside, the good pump fake. And boy, the first time I saw it, I thought it was a foul. Peterson didn't like the call, but watching the replay there, it might have been pretty clean. But
that shows you what your angle and the relative position on the floor do. It was Peterson's second foul.
Let us not forget that the officials, they only have one angle as we do here at the court. Sorry.
They do not have a replay.
Darrell, the leading scorer for the Wildcats, now with 11.
33-30. Derwin good now. Avoids the pressure. Pulls up at about 12 feet. Dumps it off to Lyton. Now snaps it off to Tally. Tally won't shoot. Instead takes it in and makes it easy. Nice drive to the hoop.
And Tally turned down that 15-footer. But found out he could get a 3-footer.
We're a one-point ball game now. Darrell to Page. Back to Ron Thompson. Thompson, top of the key. Off the corner to Richardson now. Northwestern trying to work around this Cooley zone. Pass intercepted by Raphael Peterson. Two on one to Good. Good to put it up. Get the shot up. Over power on the board.
Great left hand by Derwin Good. Peterson hit him maybe a little too early, but he made a fine shot.
Oh, scoop underneath. Knocked away by Benson. Here come the Cardinals the other way, but the pass is intercepted by Broderick Powell. Powell gets it up court to Freddie Darrough. Darrough drives the lane. No. That is scared away by the Giants. And the ball is rebounded by the Cardinals. Here is Tally. Tally drops it off to Peterson. Yes. And Cooley all of a sudden has a three-point lead. And timeout by Northwestern. All right, with the score, Cooley 36, Northwestern 33. We'll pause on the Michigan High School Athletic Association Network. Northwestern Wildcat cheerleaders whooping it up, trying to swing the momentum in their direction. Cooley with two quick baskets in a row has turned this game around and taken a three-point lead. Down at the other end, Wildcats have a little trouble inbounding it, but they probably finally do to Ron Thompson.
And it's the first time, Ed, we've seen Cooley really get that running game on track.
And that's why Grover Kirkland immediately called a timeout. He didn't want to get up involved in that up-tempo type of game. He wants to run, but only when he can run to his advantage. He wants to run in the lead. He doesn't want to be chasing. Thompson finally dumps the ball off to Reggie Richardson. In and out. Ball is grabbed by Benson. Benson been a force with another rebound. He's a double figure.
13 rebounds for Benson.
My goodness to Benson.
We're not halfway through the third quarter yet.
Now Cooley will take his time. Galley says, put that hand up. Says, let's slow it down, guys. Let's put a real good shot. We've got the three-point lead. We can force them to spread their zone, and that's what they should probably do. He's making fourth Northwestern to come out of that zone. Skip pass across to Peterson. Partially blocked by Page and retrieved by Ronnie Thompson.
Good job, William Page, getting a hand on that to deflect it.
Darrough, no place to go. Cut off by Tally. Ball stolen by Peterson. On the run. He's got Tally on the wing. Yes.
Fair game. Did you see Daniel Lyton filling the other side? The big man was right there.
5-point lead. Biggest of the ball game for the Cardinals.
Don't push here. Get the hands off.
Freddie Darrough drops it off to Reggie Richardson. He's got to make that 8-footer, and he does. He has 8 points in the ballgame. 38-35.
Well, until that hoop, it was 10-1 in favor of Cooley this quarter.
Good now. Oh, great entrance pass into Lyton. He makes it easy. 14 points for Lyton. 5-point lead for the Cardinals, trying to defend their state championship, win the Class A title for the second year in a row. Northwestern trying to bring the Class A title back to Flint for the first time since 1985 when they last won. Thompson in amongst the trees, throws it up. Lo and behold, look what I got.
Boy, what a great acrobatic move there.
He has eight. Here goes the Cardinals. Peterson in high gear, dumps it off to Benson. Good defensive pressure, and Benson's shot goes wide, and the rebound is grabbed by Richardson. He's fouled by Lyton.
Richardson, good position on the board that time. Lyton with the height advantage here, but again, Richardson shows if you get position, spread yourself out, the big man can't go over you. Watch 42 come over the top of 25 here. And you're going to get called for a foul on that every time if you get position.
First thing they teach is blockout rules and blockout techniques. That one worked. Here's Ronnie Thompson. Northwestern has a mini break, 3-on-1. Page slam is missed as Lyton got a hand in there and deflected the ball. The ball goes to the Cardinal. Good. Peterson. Tally top of the key. He's been shot from there all day. In pass to Lyton. Lyton slams it home for two more. I can't allow that pass.
I tell you, that was your basic high percentage shot. Got position for the easy lob. I mean, some lobs are tough. That was a rather easy lob to get to him where he got on the spot.
The mighty, mighty Anthony Bridges, all 5'7" of them, number 11 in for the Wildcats now. Freddie Darrough pulls up from the top of the key for a three-pointer, way short. Ball is grabbed off by Benson, but his pass is taken off by Bridges. He dumps it off to Ronnie Thompson. Thompson's shot is missed. Bridges way high in the air, but he couldn't get the rebound. The little guy can jump.
He almost got that board.
Holy Cooley settles things down now. Michael Talley at the top of the key with 2:25 to go in the third period. The Cardinals ahead by 5. Pass is knocked away by Freddie Darrough. Darrough on the run. He's got Bridges with him. Takes it himself to score.
Boy, great acceleration that time.
2 steps and he was gone, right? Whew. Back the other way, Raphael Peterson. He passed that ball to the second row. Looking for a cutting Maurice Benson, but Benson didn't cut the wrong way. With the margin at 3 now, Northwestern can cut it to 1. Richardson will inbound to Bridges.
Cooley continues to do well when they get in the running game, but the half-court offense, if they don't get it inside for the short slam or short two-footer, they're having trouble with anything other than that.
That's a good matchup. Bridges and Durwood, good. Bridges beats Page, great move. Bridges beat him.
Well, Page missed that dunk last time, and he made extra sure on that one.
Page just a junior now. Good for Cooley, being pressured by Bridges. Bridges 5'7", good 5'8". And we get a reaching foul on Freddie Darrough.
Back to that slam dunk by William Page. If we had the cards, I'm giving him a 9-5 on that one. He got the legs up, kicked him out.
Not quite as good as the one we saw today from Steginga, and he took off at about the free throw line.
That brought the house down in the Class B game earlier today.
42-41 Cooley, and the Cardinals inbound with a minute 39 to go in the third period. Baseline shot, Peterson bounces away, Page reaching, gets the ball, finally cannot see it. I think if he'd let it go out of bounds, it might have been Northwestern's ball.
Cooley, I still think, Ed, is going to eventually have to hit one of these shots from outside against this zone. Again, they are getting good success getting inside, but eventually they're going to have to shoot something from 15 to 18 feet.
They're very patient trying to get that ball into Lyton, but now with both Page and Reggie Richardson in there, it's tougher to get that ball into Lyton. Tally, Peterson, boy, they jump on him, 2-on-1. Tally puts it up to the top of the key and knocks it down. That's a big shot.
That's the one they needed. He's got 6 in the quarter, 12 in the game.
Bridges pulls it up when he doesn't have the advantage. With 1 minute to go in the third quarter, Cooley by 3. Page lost his dribble now, but he gets Ron Thompson to pass. Thompson will drive in amongst the Giants. Shot bounces short, rebounded by Benson. That's 14, I believe. And Cali has it for the Cooley Cardinals. With 43 seconds to go here in the third period. Pass. Cross court, put up, good, and in.
Nice little running left-hand jump up there by Good. He looked for the big guys to come out, and they didn't do it.
Five-point lead now. Ron Thompson. Bridges. 22 seconds. Northwestern going to the end of the court where their bench is located, so Grover Kirkland can just issue instructions from the bench without having to scream at the top of his lungs. Bridges bounce pass to Dara. Shoot.
Boy, that is so smooth. Oh,
4 seconds to go in the quarter. Good. 3-2. And foul from behind by Anthony Bridges.
Well, as many things right as Anthony Bridges has done coming in there, it's a bad foul in that situation. Fortunately for him, though, they're not shooting the bonus.
So you're going to have to inbound the ball, make it a great pass, and then shoot it up immediately in order to get a basket before the end of the period. They do that, and it doesn't work. 46-43, Cooley over Northwestern with a score. Cooley 46, Northwestern 43. From Chrysler Arena in Ann Arbor, this is the Michigan High School Sports Network. Ed Phelps along with Rick Berkey. Welcome back. This is it, the final 8 minutes of the Class A championship game between Flint Northwestern and Detroit Cooley, and the defending champions Cooley with a 3-point lead, 46-43, as we start the final period of play. That's Anthony Bridges for Northwestern in green, pursued and fouled by Derwin Good.
Good battle out there between Good and Richardson, or Bridges rather.
Bridges is 5'7", Good 5'8". It's the first time that Good's had a height advantage on anybody since probably the third grade. Northwestern to inbound, they're having a little trouble for, well, they get it off. And it's Reggie Richardson at the top of the key, buries it.
Like you said, they barely beat the 5 second count there. Richardson took advantage of it.
We're down to a 1 point ball game. Cooley underneath, Benson's got no place to go, but I believe Page will pick up his fourth foul.
Two fine passes out here. It starts on the wing. Rafael Peterson, watch, 24. He zips it into Benson on the right wing, dishes it back, there we go, inside to Lyton, and he draws a foul, but the foul committed, I believe, before the shot.
And it is on Page, it is his fourth foul, so he will come out of the ball game, and he will be replaced by your basic bulk package, Archie Munnerlin, who is at 6'3", 6'4", pardon me, 206.5, 225 pounds, did a good job in the first half.
Had 6 points, four rebounds in that first half.
One of your basic wide bodies. Cooley now can be patient. They'll look for the good possible shot. They've got the lead. Peterson puts it up from 7 feet and finds it.
Rafael Peterson, you can see confident, a little bit more confidence offensively.
Lead pass for Munnerlin. Reverse layup on the right hand, and he makes it.
Hey, the big guy showed some real soft touch with that finger roll there.
He's only a sophomore. Munnerlin almost knocked away the pass intended for Lyton. The Cardinals get it back under control, and we get a foul early from Freddie Darrough. Before, it was an important foul because it was before Peterson could get started the real good offensive move. That's Darrough's third foul.
Back to that hoop on the other end, though. I was really impressed with the way Munnerlin covered the floor. He got down there in a hurry. Nice soft touch off the glass.
48-47, Cooley over to Northwestern. You know, Flint Schools won the Class A championship 5 years in a row from 1981 through 1985. Flint Central winning it in 81, 2, and 3, and Flint Northwestern in 84 and 85. Some of the great players on that rebound, the free throw is missed. Some of the great players in those Northwestern teams included Glenn Rice. Here's Northwestern, Munnerlin again is free, but this time he misses the layup, but he gets the rebound and he is hammered. Maurice Benson got him.
And I think he came down on his hand.
I think he might have.
Oh my goodness.
Look very closely. See if we can get a replay of that.
Munnerlin, watch him coming inside here. He misses the shot and goes after the rebound here.
And we'll just watch it with you. He picks up the loose ball.
He'll come down. I think his hand is underneath. Well, we can't see it from there. But I think he comes down. His hand is underneath him. Now maybe we'll
try it again here. He gets his left hand snapped back a little bit right there. I believe it might have hurt, but
I think it was kind of two blows. One when the shot was blocked initially, snapped that wrist back a little bit, and then when he fell to the floor. I don't think it was real serious, but it certainly would be a frightening feeling there for an instant.
Well, Grover Kirkland's got a decision over there. Does he pull him out now? If he does pull him out, somebody else is going to come shoot the free throws.
Yeah, he just brings the best free throw shooter that he's got on the bench into the game. And it looks like he's elected Preston Walker a starter, though Walker has not seen much action since early in the first half and has yet to score a point. So again, it's a very small team that Northwestern has in there now, Rick. They basically are a three-guard unit with Thompson, Dara, and Bridges. Bridges at 5'7", dwarfed between Cooley's Peterson and Lyton to the left of the free throw shooter. Look at that shot. Little Bridges in there trying to get that rebound.
And I've always felt if the guy makes the free throw here, the guy who got fouled should get credit for the points.
That's not a bad thought.
He paid the price for it, but Walker gets the point, his first of the game.
All right, this team is small now for Northwestern, but they're quick. However, Cooley, once they get it down court, should have a definite advantage and be able to get it inbound. Munnelin up off the bench. He's going to come back in. We get the next play stoppage, and we get a timeout from the Cooley Cardinals. Cooley 48, Northwestern 48, 6:43 to go. We'll be back on the Michigan High School Athletic Network. Here we are, Chrysler Arena, Ed Phelps and Rick Berkey, the whooping it up fans from Flint Northwestern High School. They have reason to cheer. They have trailed for much of the last 3 or 4 minutes of the ball game, but now their Wildcats have tied the score. It is Northwestern 48, Cooley 48, with 6:43 to go in the final period. Rick Berkey, we had a three-point game in the Class B title game this morning. We may be heading for an even closer tilt this afternoon.
Ed, both huddles very animated. Grover Kirkland and the Flint Northwestern during the timeout, and Ben Kelso talking with the officials as well as his team during the 60-second break.
Here are the Cooley Cardinals. They are going to try and get it inside. Archie Munnelin is back in for Northwestern after suffering a slight injury to his left wrist when he fell after being fouled just moments ago. But Cooley will be patient. They'll try and work it inside. They have been almost reluctant totally to shoot. Here's Tally on the break. He moves to the left side, makes a great drive to the baseline and score.
Michael Tally there, really, he glided to the hoop that time.
Bridges is high speed, number 11. Got no place to go. Has to put it up. Doesn't get the shot, but the rebound is grabbed off by Northwestern. Ron Thompson with an impossible shot. Rebounded by Richardson and in.
Richardson with 12. And again, Bridges getting inside, starting the whole thing.
Bridges is a whirlwind out here for Northwestern. Now again, Tally runs the offense, number 14 for Cooley.
Now last time, Peterson turned down a 15-footer inside the three-point side there, just a little farther in there. He gets it again. I still think he should take that shot. Right in there, I think he takes step up one step, sure, and take that shot. He's a good shooter. He's not having his day, but
Tally likes to go to his left. He does again. Drives for the glass. Misses the shot. Rebound is tipped up. Battle for it. Put off by Benson. Missed again. Tip up again. Battle for underneath. They scramble for it. And Tally comes away. He'll take it back to the top of the key. Woo! Bodies in there. Banging. Whacking away. Nobody can get control. Irwin Good puts a move on. Goes to his right. Shot does not find the hoop, but it's tipped up by Benson, and he is fouled from behind by Archie Munnell.
18 rebounds for Maurice Benson. Make it 20. It was 18 going into that. Now we've got him for 20 rebounds. Watch it. He'll follow it once. Doesn't get it. Stays with it. Tips it. Draws the foul. Almost got the hoop as well. Maurice Benson, 20 rebounds.
Game tied 50-50 with 5:04 to go. Benson can put the Cardinals ahead. And he does. But he missed his first two of the ball game, the first three of the ball game, actually. Been rolling ever since. Now he's made two in a row. And four. Rattles it home. It's 52-50 in favor of the Cardinals. Bridges will lead him up court for the Wildcats. Looking left side, good on him. A lot of movement underneath. Freddie Darrough, they try and free up from about 7 feet. Has to change his shot, doesn't go in. Richardson battles for the rebound, so does Darrough. And we get a jump ball. Possession arrow pointing to the Cooley Cardinals.
It was Maurice Benson that got the hand in there, tying it up.
I think Grover liked that ball throw to Kirkland, Northwestern coach, but not much he can do about it. So now the arrow points towards Northwestern. 4:40 to go in the ball game. The Cardinals, Peterson, Tally with the ball. Good. Lyton, Benson, all trying to win the state championship for the second year in a row. Not many teams have done that in Michigan. Tally, play catch with Good. Peterson. Tally, Good. Trying, look at them trying to get inside. Watch them. They're trying to get inside to either Lyton or Benson. They desperately want to get in there, and they're just going to run the time down. They've got the two-point lead, Rick.
Northwestern back to packing it in again. I'll say you haven't shown us yet. You want that 15 to 18 footer. We know we're down by two, but what the heck?
You can see that zone defense shift and weave with the flow of the ball.
Good battle going on underneath, though, between Lyton and Ronald Thompson. Lyton with a decided height advantage. It looks like they're almost waiting for the time to lob to Lyton.
Thompson's a great jumper, and I think that's what they expect. Occasionally, when the zone works that way, you'll see Munnelin go over and give some help to Thompson, who is 6 foot, going against Lyton, who's 6'6".
Battle there at the far left of your screen. Look at Lyton, 42, trying to get position. That's where they want to go.
3 minutes to go in the ball game. Cooley 52, Northwestern 50.
This has been quite a situation here. We're going on for a good 45 seconds. Cooley is patient. They're not going to take a shot unless it's a very good shot. They've got the lead.
They've now used 1 minute, Ed.
Right. Under 3 minutes to go. Tally, Grover Kirkland issuing instructions from the Northwestern bench. Kelso watching. They did get the ball into Benson, but he tipped it right back out again, almost a touch pass. Good sends Bridges to the court with a good head fake, but nothing comes of it. Benson now back to Peterson. 2:30 to go in the ball game.
I think it's important to note there.
Peterson elects not
thought about
the
it.
Ball feeder. Now they get it into Lyton, and it pays off. Well, that was great, great patience.
I was saying, yeah, it's important to note there that it was not Cooley who chose that style to slow it down as a near steal out front by Tally, but rather it was Northwestern's defense, and now Grover Kirkland has called a timeout. He's definitely going to change things defensively.
Score, Cooley 54, Northwestern 50. We pause at the Michigan High School Athletic Association Sports Network. Welcome back. The final 2 minutes and 17 seconds of the fourth period of the Class A championship game of the Michigan High School Tournament. Cooley leads Flint Northwestern 54 to 50 with a 2:17 to play. William Page, much more of an offensive threat, comes into the ball game now for Northwestern. So it's Darren Thompson at the guard, Derrick 33, Thompson 23. The forwards are Richardson 25 and Munnerlin 53, and then Page back in at center. Getting close to the 2 minute mark. Northwestern down by four, they need some offense.
Cooley a little more leery now of the 3 point shot. They haven't been as much in the earlier parts of this half, but now again with the lead and winding down, they're a little more concerned. They don't want to lose on a couple of 3 pointers.
Both teams exhibiting extreme patience here. Northwestern cannot play the way Cooley did the last time. Cooley took over a minute to get off the shot. Thompson, no place to go. His shot is knocked away by Benson. Here is Peterson all alone. Makes a layup, but it's a 6 point ball game. And Cooley's hopes are much, much brighter now. Quickly now, Northwestern will come up court. Thompson.
Benson that blocked it on the other end.
To Darrough. Darrough pulls it up for 3 point range. No, 2 point. 2 point range for Peter, for Darrough. And it's 56-52. Now Cooley, I will get a little bit more pressure this time, I would think, for Northwestern. 1:15 to go in the ballgame, 56-52. Northwestern has to make something happen. Grover Kirkland stands up and signals four to his team.
They're in a zone, but he wants them farther out.
Yeah, he wants them out. He wants to pressure them.
Now they're matching up in a foul outside.
Ronnie Thompson goes in and gets the foul. He's got to get the clock stopped. No, he's got to take his chances now, down by four. He has to take his chances, but Cooley is not going to succeed at the foul line.
Well, Cooley struggled in that first half, 6 out of 13, but they are 4 out of 5 since the intermission. Good is 0 for 2 today.
And one. And he makes that one.
Sweetest sound in basketball.
Yeah, that or the horn at the end of the game in a one-point win. Makes them both. 6 points, Cooley lead, 58-52, 58 seconds to go. Freddie Darrough. Bridges getting set to come back in for Northwestern. Long pass cross court to Reggie Richardson. He tried the three-pointer. It bounces high and no good. Rebound, Rafael Peterson. He is fouled by Darrough.
We have that as the only rebound of the game for Rafael Peterson with 45 seconds to go. It just might be the biggest board to this point in time. Watch Peterson go inside, 24.
Long cross-court pass to Richardson. And then the shot, Rick.
And Peterson comes inside, stays with it. He came from the opposite side of the shot and got the rebound. Drew the foul.
In 1975, Grover Kirkland brought the Flint Northwestern team to Ann Arbor and lost in the finals to a Highland Park squad that featured Terry Durod, who later played for the University of Detroit, briefly for the Boston Celtics in the National Basketball Association. This is Grover's fourth trip to the championship game, and it might be his second loss.
Well, again, you go through the great heritage over at Northwestern, the Glenn Rice and Jeff Grayers and so on, but you've got to know he's so proud of this team that was 11-9 in regular season.
Andre Jackson in the game for Northwestern. Now that's Bridges. Bridges dumps it off to Dara. He's the shooter. Misses. Rebound by the Cardinals. No, picked off by Thompson. And now ahead to Peterson. Here we go. Rafael Peterson wraps it up. It's a 10-point game, 62-52 with 27 seconds to go.
Peterson, 8 points in the quarters, helped salt it away.
Ronnie Thompson, his shot is way off, rebounded by Cooley. Well, what's the old adage? You live by the jump shot, you die by the jump shot, and it has not gone Northwestern's way today. And with 17 seconds to go, it is apparent after the foul by Reggie Richardson that the Cooley Cardinals of Detroit, not even expected to get to the championship game, but upset winners over Detroit Southwestern yesterday. Nonetheless, the defending champions, the Cooley Cardinals, are about to win their second straight Class A title.
Coach Ben Kelso has his team clear out of the free throw lane right now. Just not wanting to risk any kind of foul situation.
A little technique demonstrated on national television the last two or three games by the Temple Owls. They have pulled away from the free throw line when they're way ahead. Good is good on both of them. And it's a 12-point lead, 64-52. Northwestern rushes up court. Bridges to Dara. Dara got it. And that is a three-pointer. But they needed him a little bit earlier.
And their first three-pointer of the day.
Benson will wrap it up with the basket, and that is it. The basket is good, and the Cooley Cardinals have claimed the championship for the second year in a row. The final score, Cooley, 66. It flips Northwestern 55. Let us pause now on the Michigan High School Athletic Sports Network. There you see it, the Cooley Cardinals of Detroit have claimed their second straight Class A championship of the state of Michigan, defeating Flint Northwestern 66-5. Rafael Peterson with the big dunk there to wrap it up for Cooley. Rick?
All right, the awards presentation about to get underway, and standing by, Howard King with the public address announcement.
Now we're ready for our trophy and medal presentation. First of all, to our Class A runners-up today, Flint Northwestern. To make the presentations to both teams, Mr. Roy Allen, Jr., Director of Health, Physical Education and Safety, Detroit Public Schools, and a member of the Representative Council of the MHSAA. First of all, to Flint Northwestern, number 11, Anthony Bridges. Number 13, Michael Terry. Number 15, Andre Jackson. Number 21, Roderick Powell. Number 35, Marvin Griffin. 41, James Cook. Rashamir McFarland. 51, LaRon McDaniel. 53, Archie Munerlin. 55, Demetrius Hughes. 23, Ronald Thompson. 25, Reggie Richardson. 31, Preston Walker. 33, Freddie Darrough. 45, William Payne. And to receive the trophy as runners-up Class A, Coach Grover Kirkland.
Back once again, the Class A state final over, and for the second straight time, Ed Phelps, the Detroit Cooley Cardinals are the champs.
Well, last year they weren't supposed to win the title. They beat Detroit Southwestern. This year they weren't even supposed to get to the championship game, and they did by beating Southwestern yesterday and then pulling away at the end to beat Flint Northwestern today.
Score perhaps a little deceptive, 11-point victory, and really Flint Northwestern, the undermanned Wildcats, really made a fine showing and hang right in there till the end. We have to pick the one key point in the game, and being that with 4 minutes to go.
When, around, Coach.
Coach Kelso joining us right now. But Coach, we were just talking about what we feel maybe was the key point. We want to congratulate you on the state championship win. About 4 minutes to go in the game, you go up two, and you've got the ball. Northwestern packs in the defense. Your team eats over a minute of the clock, content with the ball. Finally, you get it inside to Lyton for two. We thought that was a key.
Well, yeah, that was one of the keys. We decided that we were at enough points to win. That's all. You know, you basically do that. You know, I like to say that basketball season's over. I told anybody that if I got on TV today, I was going to ask if I could get some help in putting up our football clock. We got a football clock that's rotten in that Cooley, and we can't get it up. Basketball season's over. We got to get this football clock up. We got us a football clock. We can't get the board to help us put it up, and we need some alumni to come to our need and help us put up our football clock.
All of the Cooley Cardinal alumni right now are saying, maybe we ought to do that. The coach is doing a great job.
We went out and got the football clock. They didn't have to get under that. We got that. So now we need some help to just put it up. If you don't have a football clock, then you know how tough it is to go to a football game and not know what's going on.
Awful tough. Coach, it's the play of Maurice Benson. We had him for 12 points, 20 rebounds.
Oh, yeah. He played a phenomenal game. He has always come through. He's averaging 15 rebounds a game, see? And he made a big, big difference because, you see, when they go and double-team Daniel Lyton, that leaves him open. That's the worst thing you could do. He goes after it.
It's been kind of a difficult season for you, a season that you didn't expect. It was tough at the early going, but you got the team together, and then they've been on the roll in recent weeks.
Yeah, it was very, very tough at the beginning of the year. You know, I had young kids. You know, they were 16 years old. They won the state championship last year, and they come back this year, and you just could not tell them anything. They all believed that they were very good basketball players. Then they started thinking individualized, okay? One guy wants to do everything. The other guy says that he's jealous of the other guy doing it. And I had to start suspending kids. I had to start keeping kids off. I just had to start teaching them that, you know, the basketball, there is more to it than just coming on the floor and being a superstar. And once we straightened out a lot of things and started people getting along together a lot better, then things started to gel. But you got to do that in the beginning of the year, and you really can't be so concerned about winning every basketball game because you have a 20-game season, and I honestly believe that in a 20-game season, you're trying to prepare your team for the state title. And that's the basic thing that I try to do.
Coach, did you feel any carryover from the big win in the semis yesterday over Southwestern?
Well, basically, I didn't really feel any carryover. I thought we would have a big letdown, you know, because we really came in to play Southwestern, and we really thought that we were a very good team. I know the Swami never picks us, but we thought we were a very good basketball team, and we were all set to play Southwestern. We wanted to play. I don't think that the game would have been as low scoring had he not played zone, but we were actually ready to play basketball yesterday, and it would have been very tough for any team to beat us yesterday.
Final question, Coach. It appears to me you're a very young team. You've got a lot of talent that's underclassmen going to be back next year. Do you have a little bit of a run going here, maybe three in a row?
No.
You don't want to get you on television and force you to say that, but
no,
it looks like you've got some talent coming back.
No, I do have some people coming back. It's just a matter of how many people gel and how many other teams around the state. There's some very good teams that are going to be back next year. There's some excellent basketball teams in the public school league, and the public school league now is getting to the point where it has much, much better coaches, and these guys are starting to work together. They're working with each other's teams and stuff. You're going to see some very fine teams from the public school league in the future.
Great, Ben.
Go celebrate with your team, Coach.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, Coach, very much. Congratulations.
Interesting, he talked about earlier in the season. I think it's certainly worth noting how something negative, at least apparently negative, can turn into a positive. They had some problems, made some suspensions, laid down the law, but the team got together, turned things around. So things that maybe turned sour, you can still salvage a great season.
And it also shows you the role of the coach is not just on the court when he's coaching the game, not just conducting drills. There's more to it. And Coach Ben Kelso obviously fills all those roles.
We talked about the play of Benson inside, and Daniel Lyton just really strong. We were impressed with him last year. He's looking stronger, and you know that somewhere down the line he's going to be a very fine college basketball player.
You're absolutely right.
Well, again, we've had two games already. We've got a champion crowned in Class B, Grand Rapids South Christian, in a very, very thrilling game. Defeated Redford Bishop Board just 69-66. And right here now, the Class A game finished up, and Detroit Cooley wins its second straight Class A title.
66-55. I think we're going to take a break now. Is that right, guys? All right, we'll be paused for a break, and then we'll be back on the Michigan High School Athletic Sports Network. Ed Phelps, along with Rick Berkey, back on the Michigan High School Athletic Association Sports Network. We have just seen our second champion crown for the day, and it is in Class A, and it is, of course, Detroit Cooley, winning for the second year in a row, beating Flint Northwestern today 66-55, Rick.
Well, Ed, we have to maybe look at overall terms right now. Maybe the pendulum swung back now. Maybe the city of Detroit, the Detroit area, has recaptured the strength in Class A, at least in terms of the state championship. You know, Flint had that run. We talked about it. Flint Central, those great teams. Flint Northwestern, those super, super teams. And then Romulus 3 years ago, and now Detroit Cooley the last 2 years. maybe it's coming back to Detroit.
Now, if you think you're going to get me on public television or any kind of television anywhere to admit that Flint is no longer the power in Class A basketball in Michigan, you are wrong. I know Detroit's won the last two titles, but Flint's got some great teams coming ahead, too.
Oh, they do. And looking at this team here, and we want to get a chance following our broadcast here to talk to Grover Kirkland, and the situation being that, this young team that he had here coming in 11-9 in the regular season to get to the finals, to win seven straight games after going 11-9 with the injuries, the academic problems and everything, that was just a great tribute to the young men and to coach.
Okay, let's take a moment. We've got a moment or two here, so I'll tell you what let's do. We've talked basketball today. We've done two championship games. Let's think a little bit about football for a minute. I know November 28th is a long time ago, but it's still very fresh in the minds of the young men who competed in the state football finals at the Silverdome. Let's take a look at now to look back and share the excitement of the four champions that were decided that day.
On Saturday, November 28th, the 1987 state football championships were played at the Pontiac Silverdome, where weather conditions are always perfect for the players and the fans. Our opening game in Class D matched the Beale City Aggies, coached by Ben Steele, and the Martin Clippers, coached by Robert Kubiak. We pick up action in the first quarter. Martin quarterback Ron Orr back to pass. He hits tight end Jeff Martin, 13 yards and a Clipper first down. Later in the quarter, Martin goes to the air once again. This time, Orr's pass is intercepted by Beale City's Matt Fox. Fox turns around and makes a nifty 25-yard return for the Aggies, and this halts the Clippers' scoring threat. Later, Beale City's Tom Sherrar punts. Martin's Randy Hunt grabs it, and watch three great blocks on the sideline. It's a 26-yard return, and the Clipper fans are loving it. In the second quarter now, Beale City quarterback Tom Zenn hits receiver Matt Miller, who pitches to trailer Matt Fox. It's an 18-yard beauty for the Aggies. Midway through the half now, Martin's Orr back. He looks for flanker Jeff Crosby. He's got it, and you're not going to catch Jeff. 55 yards for the touchdown. Martin goes on top, 7-0. Now late in the half, Beale City fights back. Tom Zenn goes back. He hits Danny Pung out of the backfield, 25 yards and a first down for the Aggies. There's no more scoring in the half, though, and as the Martin Clipper marching band performs, Martin leads 7-0 at the intermission. Now third quarter action. Martin's Orr runs the option, pitches to Randy Hunt, and watch Dandy Randy make some great moves. The play covers 67 yards, and Martin leads 14-0. Just a couple of minutes later, Martin gets the ball back. Orr goes airborne, and watch this remarkable catch by Jeff Crosby. Great concentration. This one goes 69 yards, and Martin is now on top 21-0. But Beale City doesn't quit. On third down and 29 yards to go, Zenn goes up the middle to Todd Schaefer, who makes a great catch, 33 yards and an Aggie first down. We come to the end of the third quarter. Martin still leads by three touchdowns. In the fourth quarter, Martin's defense stays tough. Jeff Crosby on the prowl, makes the sack. And as the final seconds tick away, Robert Kubiak gets a dousing on the Martin sideline. Beale City's Ben Steele accepts the Class B runner-up trophy. And Coach Kubiak and the Clippers celebrate the Class D state championship. The Class A title game matched Ann Arbor Pioneer and Redford Catholic Central from Detroit. Redford was jumping for joy to be in the Silverdome. Pioneer was set for some good old-fashioned head knocking. In the first quarter, Redford's Chris Kobath follows some good blocking. He goes 13 yards and a first down for the Shamrocks. On the same drive, Redford's Pete Elezovic's 37-yard field goal is off to the right, and Pioneer holds its ground. Late in the first quarter now, Pioneer's Adam Hint twists his way downfield, 18 yards and a first down. As the quarter ends, the game is still scoreless. It was a day for the defense. Exhibit A right here, Redford's Scott McKee and Eric Knuth stuffed the Pioneer ball carrier. Midway through the second, Pioneer's left-footed kicker Chris Moore tries a 35-yard field goal, It's good. Pioneer leads 3-0, and this kick would look bigger as the day goes on. On the last play of the half, Moore tries another field goal, but it's partially blocked by the Redford defense. As the Pioneer band plays at the half, Pioneer leads 3-0. In the third quarter, defense continues to dominate. Pioneer's Leonard Cobbs and Brian Bradley stop this play right away. Late in the third quarter, Pioneer quarterback Rob Ferrari hits Cortez Page with a nice pass, 14 yards and a first down. After three quarters, it's still anyone's game. We head now for the final 12 minutes. In the fourth quarter, Redford quarterback Scott Hauncher back to pass. He hits tight end Lou Yeager for 18 yards, and Redford's on the move. But Pioneer holds, gets the ball back, and Aaron Bailey makes a great cut. He goes 43 yards before he's finally tripped up, and the Pioneer fans can smell victory. Two plays later, Bailey breaks four tackles en route to a very important first down for Pioneer. Redford keeps battling back, though, but on the final play of the game, Pioneer's Mike Towler makes the sack that ends it. Pioneer hangs on to win the lowest scoring game in state championship history. Redford Catholic Central coach Tom Mock receives the runner-up trophy, and Pioneer coach Chuck Laurie and the Pioneers celebrate the Class A state championship. The Class C championship pitted the Eagles of Erie Mason and Saginaw Nouvelle Catholics Panthers. Nouvelle is coached by Smokey Boyd and Erie Mason by Al Romano. The fans were just getting into their seats when Nouvelle's Chuck Williams brings them out of their seats with a 33-yard return of the opening kickoff. Later in the quarter, Erie Mason's Darren Bowman finds tight end Homer Shields on the right flat. The play covers 36 yards. First down, Eagles. Later, Erie Mason gambles on 4th-and-9 with a fake punt. Bowman makes it a good gamble by connecting with Joe Robinson for a 15-yard play and first down. But Nouvelle's defense stiffens, and Erie Mason's kick is off to the left. We go to the second quarter, still scoreless. Late in the half, Erie Mason's Todd Coslow tries again from 37 yards, and the goalpost shows how tough it was to score points at the Dome that day. As the players went to the locker room, it was still a scoreless tie. In the third quarter, the offense picks up. Erie Mason's Darren Bowman hits split end Marcos Villalobos for 18 yards and an Eagle first down. But Nouvelle's defense digs in again as Brian Adams intercepts to end the threat. But the Eagles get it back, and Darren Bowman keeps it on the option, breaks a couple of tackles. He goes 21 yards for the first score of the game. Erie Mason leads 7-0. Now we're in the fourth quarter, and Nouvelle's Dan Boussier goes back to pass. He lofts a picture-perfect toss to James DeBartoleven. It's a 42-yard touchdown, and we're tied 7-7 as the Nouvelle fans celebrate. Later in the fourth, Erie Mason's Darren Bowman runs the option, pitches to his brother Derek. Derek rambles 38 yards all the way down to the Nouvelle 4-yard line. From there, Ed St. Bernard bulldogs his way over the line for the TD, and Erie Mason leads 14-7. That score proves to be the difference as Erie Mason wins it. Nouvelle coach Smokey Boyd accepts the runner-up trophy. And Erie Mason's Al Romano holds aloft the Eagles' Class C state championship trophy. The final game of the day matched the Cougars of Grand Rapids Catholic Central and the Hawks of Farmington Hills Harrison. Grand Rapids Catholic is coached by Jim Galvin and Harrison by John Harrington. In the first quarter, Harrison's Phil Ryder comes up and makes a fine defensive play. Harrison sophomore quarterback Mill Coleman shows why people are talking about him on this 14-yard quarterback draw play. After one period, there was no score. In the second quarter, Grand Rapids Catholic's Jim Passanaw hits Brad Mathis for a 16-yard pass play and a Cougar first down. Later on that same drive, Passanaw back to pass, and Harrison's Wes Wood intercepts to halt the Cougars' scoring threat. Later, the Cougars try a screen pass, but Harrison's Jim Folks makes an outstanding play for an 11-yard loss. The Cougars have to punt, and Matt Smith has the punt of the day at the Silverdome. It's 55 yards and downed at the 7-yard line. The half comes to an end, and for the second straight game, there's no score. Third quarter action now, Catholic Central on the move. Jim Passanall rolls left, fires into the end zone, and hits Dan Tiedema for the touchdown. The Cougars lead 7-0. Later, Harrison's Coleman has to punt. He gets off a pretty good one. The Grand Rapids Catholics' Perry Foster takes the kick, makes a fine return, shows some great individual moves. He goes 35 yards to get his team moving again. As Foster gets a well-deserved breather, later the Cougars line up for a field goal, but it's a fake. Holder Mike Seaman throws a perfect pass to Brad Mathis. It's a 31-yard touchdown, and the Cougars lead 13-0. But Harrison's not dead yet. Mill Coleman goes back. He finds Brian Waldron for a 41-yard play. That sets up a TD that makes it 13-7. But the Cougars go to the air again. Passanoff finds Darby Spielmaker. It's a 55-yard play for the touchdown. Grand Rapids Catholic Central has a 2-touchdown lead once again. The score ends 19-7, and the celebration starts on the field. Farmington Hills Harrison John Harrington accepts the runner-up trophy, while Cougar coach Jim Galvin gets a victory ride to celebrate the Class B state championship, closing a very exciting day of football at the Silverdome.
Well, the football reprieve was nice, but we're here talking basketball today, Rick. We have two champions crowned so far.
That's right. We're only halfway through. We've got two more to come in Class B, Grand Rapids South Christian, now in Class A, Detroit Cooley. And now we'll come back at 7 o'clock tonight with the D.C. doubleheader.
The D.C. doubleheader, a couple of surprise teams in Beale City. The Aggies, mostly a football power, but they're in the championship game against Northport from up in the Leelanau Peninsula there.
So a couple from the northern part of the lower peninsula. Then the C game follows the 20-minute break in between there. And we've got the defending champion, Saginaw Nouvelle, coming in.
We have one defending champion repeat today, and that was Cooley. Saginaw Nouvelle will try and make it two in a row in Class C. And they will be taking on a very surprising Roscommon team. The Roscommon Bucks, who weren't supposed to be anywhere close to this building on this date, but they're here.
And they may be the most fun team to watch. I mean, they get out there and just do their thing. And so I don't think they'll be affected by the pressure at all.
Okay, so we hope that you'll join us for our third telecast later tonight, the D.C. doubleheader starting at 7. For Rick, I'm Ed Phelps. Good afternoon, everybody.